Hey friends, welcome to my channel Dental Edge. I'm Dr. Bhanuchuk and today I'm going to talk about a very commonly asked question, that is a dentistry assist. Now there can be a long question or a short note, MCQs, fill up the blanks, viva questions, as well as the slide can be kept for identification. So do watch the video till the end. Also, I have already made a lecture on the classification of odontogenic cyst, definition of cyst and parts of the cyst. I'm mentioning the link below in the description box as well as here up on the screen. Do check that video as well. Now, let's get started with dentigerous cyst. Dentigerous cyst is a cyst that surrounds the crown of an impacted or an embedded tooth. If you can see this image, here there is a impacted tooth is there within the bone and there's a cyst that surrounds it, right? Now, how is it formed? Basically, if you remember your first year BDS, the formation of a tooth, there is a dental lamina. This dental lamina, it forms the enamel organ. This enamel organ, it takes up various shapes. First there is bud stage, then there is cap stage, and then there is bell stage. Now when this enamel of the tooth is completely formed, this enamel organ, it gets reduced or shrinked into reduced enamel epithelium. It acts as a protective covering around the tooth and it consists of the outer and inner enamel epithelial cells. Now the dentigerous cyst is formed when there is fluid accumulation between the enamel surface of the impacted tooth and the reduced enamel epithelium, leading to the expansion of the dental follicle. So a dentigerous cyst, it can be defined as an odontogenic cyst that surrounds the crown of an impacted tooth. We have seen it already. Caused by fluid accumulation between the reduced enamel epithelium and the enamel surface, resulting in a cyst in which the crown is located within the lumen. You can appreciate it in this image. This is a gross specimen and the tooth crown is located within the cyst. So this is basically a dentigerous cyst. So one more important point you should remember is it is a cyst that is attached at the neck of the tooth or at the cemento enamel junction. If you can appreciate in this image, the cyst, it is attached to the neck of the tooth in the cross specimen. Beside it, you can see this is the tooth and the cystic lining. If you can see, it is attached at or near the cemento enamel junction. So what are the important points? A cyst that surrounds the crown of an impacted tooth, formed by fluid accumulation between the reduced enamel epithelium and the enamel surface. The cystic cavity, it contains the crown of the tooth, and the cyst is always attached at the neck of the tooth or at the CEJ. Now, if you remember the classification of odontogenic cyst that was already covered in the last lecture, you will see that it falls in the category of developmental odontogenic cyst. Also, you can see that the tissue of origin is reduced enamel epithelium. Now, this is one of the most common types of developmental odontogenic cyst, accounting for 20% of all jaw cysts. And around, as I already told you, it's always associated with an impacted tooth. 10% of impacted tooth, they may show presence of a dentigerous cyst. It is usually seen associated with a normal permanent impacted tooth, and sometimes it is associated with a deciduous tooth. Now the other name for dentigerous cyst is a follicular cyst, and this can be a viva question. What is the other name of dentigerous cyst? Or you can be asked to write about follicular cyst, so you should know it. Although this name follicular cyst is not very apt, since it shows that it is of mesodermal origin, and the term follicular cyst is usually used for follicular cyst of the ovary or the hair follicular cyst. So the more appropriate name is dentigerous cyst, because the word dentigerous cyst, it means tooth bearing, and since this cyst, it contains a tooth within the lumen, so this is the most appropriate name. Now let's see what are the clinical features of a dentigerous cyst. Now I always tell you in my lectures, in clinical features you have to mention about what is the common age in which the lesion will occur, what's the site of occurrence, in which sex it is more commonly seen, what will be the signs and symptoms. So a dentigerous cyst, it will always be associated with an unerupted tooth. It can be impacted or embedded. Now, what's an impacted and what's an embedded tooth? Impacted tooth is when the tooth fails to erupt into the oral cavity because of some local obstruction. For example, if there is lack of space in the dental arch, or if due to some other tooth it is not able to erupt into the oral cavity, so it's an impacted tooth. Embedded tooth is when a tooth fails to erupt into the oral cavity because of lack of eruptive forces. So a dentigerous cyst, it will be involved with an impacted or an embedded unerupted tooth. First thing, if you can appreciate in this image, can you see how beautifully this cyst, it surrounds the tooth structure and the roots of the teeth are visible, right? Now, sometimes it may also be associated with a complex or compound odontome. A lecture has already been made on the same, or a supernumerary teeth. Coming to the site of occurrence, as we know, it's associated with an unerupted or an impacted tooth. So what are the most common impacted tooth? These are the mandibular third molar, maxillary canine, maxillary third molar, mandibular second premolar. So these are the most commonly affected sites. Coming to the age, it is usually seen in second to third decade of life. And coming to the sex predilection, it is more commonly seen in males than in females, and the ratio being 3:2. Now usually the dentigerous cyst is solitary, that is a single cyst is there, but sometimes it can be either bilateral, that it is present on both the sides of the jaw, or it is multiple cysts are present. These are seen in certain syndromes, and this can be a Viva question, that in which syndrome you see presence of bilateral or multiple dentigerous cyst, and the answer is cleidocranial dysplasia and Marutu-Lamy syndrome. Now the dentigerous cyst, they may grow to a large size before they are diagnosed, and it may be diagnosed accidentally on a radiograph when the patient comes, for example, with the complaint of a missing tooth or a tilted or malaligned tooth. And they are usually painless, but occasionally it may become painful if it becomes secondarily infected. Now, the dentigerous cyst, it has the potential to become an aggressive lesion, that is, it can grow to a large size, can cause expansion of the bone, facial asymmetry, displacement of the teeth, severe root resorption of the adjacent teeth, and pain can also be there. For example, cystic involvement of a mandibular third molar, it can lead to hollowing of the entire ramus, and the tooth, that is the mandibular molar, it may be pushed towards the inferior border of the mandible. Now coming to the radiographic features of a dentigerous cyst, remember that it's a radiolucency, unilocular radiolucency with well-defined sclerotic border that surrounds the crown of an impacted tooth. Usually it is unilocular, sometimes there can be multilocularity because of trabeculae of bone extending between it. And the border is usually smooth unless it is secondarily infected. Now, a normal unerupted tooth, it is surrounded by the dental follicle, or there is a follicular space, a radiolucent area is there surrounding a normal unerupted tooth. It's sometimes very difficult to differentiate between an enlarged follicle, dental follicle, and a small dentigerous cyst, since they are histologically identical. So remember that the normal follicular space is 3 to 4 mm. And a dentigerous cyst can be suspected if this follicular space, that is the radiolucent area around the unerupted tooth, is more than 5 mm. Only when the size of this radiolucency is grossly pathologic, then the distinction between an enlarged dental follicle and a small dentigerous cyst can be made with confidence. So normal follicular space 3 to 4 mm. For a dentigerous cyst, it has to be more than 5 mm. Now, a very important question that is asked as a short note, and you should know this, is what are the radiographic variations of a dentigerous cyst? So there are three radiographic variations. These are central, lateral, and circumferential, as you can see it on the image. Now, central variety is when the dentigerous cyst, it symmetrically surrounds the crown of the tooth. And In these instances, the pressure is applied in such a manner on the tooth that the tooth is pushed away from its direction of eruption. So, for example, a mandibular third molar, it may be seen lying towards the lower border of the mandible or in the ascending ramus. Or the maxillary canine may be seen in the maxillary sinus. Now the second variety is the lateral type, which results when the dilatation of the follicle, as you can see on the image, it takes place on one aspect of the crown. Commonly it is seen when the mandibular third molar, it is partially erupted and its superior surface is exposed. So there is dilatation of the follicle on one aspect of the crown. The third is a circumferential type. In this, the follicle expands in such a manner that the cyst appears to cover the entire tooth. Now, let's see these images. In the first image, we can appreciate that this is the central type and there is an impacted mandibular third molar that is pushed towards the lower border of the mandible and the cyst is symmetrically covering it. This is the central variety. The other image, you can see there is a lateral variant where the follicle is dilated on one aspect of the tooth structure. The third image that you can see is of the circumferential type, and in this, the cyst, as you can see, it appears to completely surround the tooth structure up to the roots. One more thing that you can appreciate is there is resorption of the roots of the adjacent molar. Here there is resorption, then there is resorption here as well. Now coming to the histopathologic features of the dentigerous cyst, it is not very characteristic to differentiate it from other odontogenic cysts. Now as we all know, a cyst, it has a lumen, then there is an epithelial lining and outside this there is presence of a connective tissue capsule. So in case of dentigerous cyst, there is a thin connective tissue wall which is derived from the dental follicle. So there is presence of young fibroblast and there is abundant ground substance giving it a myxomatous appearance. Then coming to the epithelium, since the epithelial lining of the cyst is derived from the reduced enamel epithelium, there is presence of 3 to 4 layers of flat to cuboidal cells, that is there is presence of thin stratified squamous epithelial lining. And this epithelium is characteristically not characterized. Retipec formation is usually absent unless it is secondarily infected. One more important thing, there is presence of odontogenic islands. These are seen in a normal dental follicle as well as in dentigerous cyst connective tissue wall. These odontogenic islands, they can be inactive and sparse, or sometimes they can be sufficient in number. Inflammatory cell infiltration of the capsule is common, but the reason is not very clear. Cysts which show presence of inflammatory infiltrate, they will show presence of Rushton bodies. Now this can be a viva question, what are Rushton bodies? These are peculiar, linear, often curved, hyaline bodies of unknown origin. It is thought that they are of hematologic origin. If you can see in this image, these linear curved structures, these pin-like structures, these are the Rushton bodies and they may be seen if there is presence of inflammation. These are seen in the epithelial lining. One more important viva question is, what are the contents of the lumen of the dentigerous cyst? It usually contains a thin yellow colored fluid which may sometimes be blood tinged. In some cysts in the epithelial lining, there may be presence of mucus secreting cells. This is due to metaplasia. Now coming to the treatment of a dentigerous cyst, this depends upon the size of the cyst. Smaller cysts, they are enucleated, that is they are completely removed surgically. In case of larger cyst, a surgical drain is created, that is marsupialization is done, and recurrence is very uncommon. Now coming to the potential complications, this is very important, you should remember. There are three potential complications. First is ameloblastoma. An ameloblastoma may develop from the lining epithelium of the dentigerous cyst or from the odontogenic islands that are present in the capsule. Second is epidermoid carcinoma. It may also develop from the lining epithelium or the odontogenic islands. And the third is mucoepidermoid carcinoma, that may develop from the, since the epithelium, it has the potential to form mucus secreting cells, a mucoepidermoid carcinoma may also develop from the dentigerous cyst. This is most commonly seen in dentigerous cyst associated with impacted mandibular third molars. So this can be viva portion. What are the potential complications? That is a dentigerous cyst. It may turn into an ameloblastoma, or it may develop into an epidermoid carcinoma or into a mucoepidermoid carcinoma.
So we are done with the topic. My next lecture will be on odontogenic keratocyst, that is an OKC. Also, if there's any other topic that you want to read, or if there's any suggestion or feedback, do leave it in the comment box. Also friends, it takes lots of effort to make such videos. Your one like can give me lots of encouragement. So do like, subscribe and share. Thank you.